Good evening, hello and welcome. It's Friday, it's 8 o'clock and that means it's time for Buster's Virtual Jazz Club. So hope you're all well, I hope you've had a good week and do say hello. We've got the chat box open and it's nice to know there's a few people out there when we're doing this. Hello Real Sonic, hello Gustafa and hello everyone else. Welcome. So we've got a before I start, I've got a new Patreon supporter who I've got to say a big thank you to, Mr. John Shannon. Thank you, John, for joining us on Patreon, and for anyone else would like to join us and get their special bonus Spotify playlist, then they can do that. There'll be more information coming up later. So my guest this evening, ladies and gentlemen, has been a highly respected figure on the UK jazz scene for many years. Not only a firm favourite amongst the finest of British jazz musicians, he's also worked with many great visiting Americans, such as Art Farmer, Bobby Shue, Al Conn, Tal Farlow, Slide Hampton, Warren Vache, Al Gray, and many others. He's an expert in many styles of jazz, including early jazz and playing free, but he's probably best known as a champion of the very demanding Lenny Tristano School of Improvisation, which I'm sure we'll talk more about this evening. He's had some particularly fruitful musical relationships and made several great albums in partnership with the great Dave Cliff, who will be a guest on my show in a few weeks' time, and also with Nicky Isles, who featured in episode number 3. He's also a highly respected educator and for many years has led a successful jazz course at Sussex University, as well as being a visiting professor at many of the top UK conservatoires. And he's also a firm favourite amongst many of the participants at our annual Jazz Summer School. I'm pleased to say he's here with us now, live on YouTube. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the very brilliant Geoff Simkins. Hello, mate. How are you? Thank you for joining us. Thanks for giving up your time and sharing your time and your music this evening. I'm very pleased that you're here. It's great to have you on the show. How's things? How are you getting on? I mean, it's a funny old year it's been, hasn't it? Yeah. Yeah, that's one more than me. Yeah. But are you doing, I mean, some people who I've talked to have said, well, they've been writing, they've been doing a lot of practice, or, and I don't know about you, but some days are better than others, aren't they? Sometimes you feel like, oh God, you know, I can't face this. And then other times you feel, well, I've got some time to do things that I didn't have time to do before, or, yeah. 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 Oh, okay. Sorry, mate. Okay, I'm sorry. There's no sound coming through. What a disaster. Right, okay, I've got to fix this. Okay, right, everyone. Oh, dear. Let me try this. Oh, dear, we did a sound check as well. How's that? Can you, Geoff, do you want to say something?
Yeah, I'm sorry, okay, mate. Can you hear that?
Are we getting Geoff now, there? Folks? Someone say we're getting Geoff. Yeah. Give us a little.
Can anybody hear me out there?
Of course, the thing is, I can hear Geoff clearly, and he sounds wonderful. Yeah, the thing is, there's about a 30-second delay on the YouTube feed. It's fixed. Okay. It's okay. Thank you. Oh, crikey. I'm so sorry, folks. Oh, it was going so well, was it? And we did a sound check as well yesterday, because I probably fiddled with something somewhere along the lines. So should we? Well, I'm not going to do all that again. We were saying that how badly things are, really, how bad this year's been. And Geoff was telling us about how he's been spending a lot of time practicing and playing. But you were just about to say how hard it is with the rest of it.
Yeah, I mean, I've always enjoyed practicing and playing and refining what I do. That's not a problem. So I've continued doing that every day. But there's no end result. You're not looking forward to a gig or a recording or a workshop. And so although there's great enjoyment and satisfaction by playing, there's a big chunk of your musical life which has just disappeared, and that's the interaction with other musicians in the same space, and that's impossible to get any other way.
I think Simon Spillett actually made a good point as well. He says, because when you spend a lot of time on the road and you go up and, you know, these people become your friends that you see at the venues, even though it's only, you know, a couple of times a year you'll go or something like that. And over a long period of time, you make these connections with people up and down the country that we do, because, you know, we do spend a lot of time on the road, don't we? And playing at sort of places that we wouldn't otherwise necessarily go to visit, just because you just wouldn't get around to it. And so you get, it's just not seeing everyone, isn't it? Anyway, let's not all get too, it'll be over one day. And we can do new things like this. So I thought we'd start with today. We've got a few selections today, but we've got a couple of videos that are a bit longer. So we've decided, you suggested that we would play longer tracks and less of them. So we're going to start with this long, because it's so hard, isn't it, to cut people off. We've got this video, and it's not particularly long, but watching a video is very enjoyable to see. And so we're going to start with the trio, which is one of your more recent projects, which is the trio with Nicky Isles and Dave Green, which is just a wonderful group of players. I think you all complement each other so wonderfully. You've all obviously known each other a very long time.
Mm.
How did that trio come about? Has it always sort of been something in the background, or is it one of those things where you go, oh, I've always wanted to work with these guys, or was there something that kind of... Or it just kind of evolved, or one, you know.
Well, I played with Nicky a lot over probably 20 years and more, and we'd intended to do a duo recording, and we actually did a session, but it was the day after the Brexit vote, and we all turned up at the studio, and the atmosphere was so extraordinary. Everyone was so dispirited that we played the session and recorded the music, and then Nicky phoned me and said, "Let's do another session." That was such a bizarre event. So fortunately, Dave Green was free, so we said, "Let's do it with Dave and do it as a trio," and it worked so fantastically well. So it was very serendipitous. You know, it's the only good thing to come out of the Brexit vote, in my opinion,
was this trio. Yeah.
but the resulting recording was so great, and we've been working as a trio since then. Yeah, so I've known Nicky and Dave, both of them, for many years.
I was just to say, have you played with Dave? I mean, Dave's just like a just incredible, one of those guys that's just been on the scene and done so much.
Yes, I played with Dave probably first in the Spike Wells Quartet, which is, you know, well over 30 years ago, with Mick Pine or Colin Purbrook.
Yeah, fantastic. And he's somebody I'd love to get on the show as well. And I'll definitely try and get that. So let's watch a bit of this video. So this is a live video, obviously, of a gig. This is from a live gig, because sometimes now a lot of musicians are doing these kind of YouTube videos, aren't they, where they're doing like promo videos. So I just thought I'd, you know, let everybody know. So this is from a gig at the Verdict in Brighton.
In Brighton, yeah. And it was for the launch of the CD. It was the gig too.
Ah, this is the album launch. Okay, yeah. So this is from 2018, or is it 20? Yeah, fantastic. So this is, and this is a tune called Elsa. And so this is live from the Verdict. This is Geoff Simkins on the alto, Nicky Isles on the piano, and Dave Green on the bass, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Wonderful, lovely. That was the a live performance there, obviously, of the album launch. This wonderful trio featuring my guest Geoff Simkins on saxophone, Nicky Isles on the piano, and Dave Green on the bass. And we should say, of course, this album, it's called In a Quiet Way, and it's on Symbol Records. Now, I've put a link below in the YouTube thing. If you go down there, folks, there's a link to a couple of other albums on Symbol Records that Geoff's made, but I couldn't find a link to that one. I guess it's they never updated it yet. But the album is In a Quiet Way. And we were talking in while that was playing there, Geoff, and I thought it was some interesting things. So I, if you don't mind, we could talk about that again. Mm. You were saying about how you enjoy playing in small groups and why that was, and how you felt that that helped the music was, it was more kind of, you could go in more directions perhaps with that.
I enjoy playing in actually in very small groups. I've done a lot of duo playing at the trio, obviously, with Nicky and Dave, and I find that it's much easier to change musical direction and to go in unexpected directions when there are fewer musicians. It's far easier to organize that and far easier for musicians to respond to each other. Of course, that it demands that all the musicians are interested in doing that, and not all musicians are. You know, some musicians want to do what they do. But Nicky and Dave are both fantastically generous in that way. They'll respond to what I do, and hopefully I can do the same. I know in that version of Elsa, I mean, I always try when I, before I'm, start a solo, I try to start with an absolutely clear mind. I don't have something prepared.
Right. Very interesting.
And I remember starting that solo, and I just used the last phrase that Nicky had played at the end of her solo, and that immediately suggested things to me that I then felt I could develop. So
is this because you feel like if you do that, you can almost surprise yourself? I was talking a bit to Liam Noble about this when he was on the show as well, and it's like putting is it you're deliberately putting yourself in a situation to see what happens, or is it because you just don't want to play what you played before? I mean, that takes a lot of discipline, I think, as well. Or is it a? Is this something you always do, or is it?
It's something I always try and do.
That's the goal.
The excitement of improvising is to improvise.
Right. Yeah. I know. It sounds obvious, but I think people don't realise actually that because of, you know, there's a lot we can, when you craft a piece, you don't always, not everybody does that, do they?
I'm certainly not putting it forward as a superior method. It's just for me, that's the thrill of it, is to see what happens. And sometimes the decisions I make are quite clearly the wrong ones. But that's the point of improvising for me. And when it works, it's worth it. And I remembered playing that solo, and I remember the beginning of it, and Nicky's phrase immediately, I thought, that's it, that's what I'm going with.
And that's just one, that little germ of an idea.
Yeah, that's
and so,
right.
So
yeah.
the job then is, what can I do with this? How can I extrapolate? How can I turn this into a whole new piece of music, as it were? There's a compositional kind of thing element in there as well, I think one of the reasons a lot of people don't do it is it's incredibly difficult. I think we should point out as well. Yeah, yeah. And it takes an enormous amount of skill, you know, because you're not just relying on things that you've got safe. A lot of the times when we're learning jazz and the students are studying, we work on pathways and strategies. And I talk about that a lot in my workshops about development of strategy for your solo. But I think the students need that. We're talking on a higher plane here when you're working like that. It does take demands a lot of skill. So I think what we traditionally would do at this point in the show is to ask about, you know, how you got started, perhaps some early days. Now I know not everyone knows, but I know you still do play drums, but you started on drums, didn't you?
Played
with quite a well-known group, the Temperance Seven, wasn't it?
Yeah, I was. But when I first started playing the drums, I was very interested in early New Orleans music. So I was interested in Baby Dodds and Cy Frazier and a lot of those very archaic players.
I mean, it's all the drummers of those days were just fabulous, weren't they?
Fabulous.
Brass and as well, trumpets, obviously, with Louis and King Olive and that. But the drums, I think, were really that era for drummers. It's kind of drummers' music as much as anyone else's, isn't it?
And often with very minimalist kits, you know, sometimes a snare and a bass drum and one cymbal, you know,
and
a woodblock.
But
absolutely sublime playing, you know. Baby Dodds was just a great master in any era, you know. And so I was certainly interested in that. Then I became interested in the music of the 20s, Louis and Bix and the classic sort of New York, Chicago music.
Yeah.
And so when I switched to saxophone, I was very interested in Frank Trumbad, Jimmy Dorsey, early Hodges, that music.
This was familiar, this music already. This was the music.
I mean, my father was a very good tenor player, semi-pro tenor player. And my older brother, Peter, fortunately, is still playing. And he was very interested and still is in Ralph Sutton and Dick Wellstead and that sort of the great stride players. And so I grew up listening to that music. So it was perfectly natural for me to play. I mean, I was the only person at school who did. And I made Avril, my partner, I always make a laugh when I say that, you know, all my schoolmates used to write on their duffel bag, they used to write Stones and Beatles and that. And I used to write Myth Mole and King Oliver and immediately seen as a complete outcast at school. Yeah. But possibly dangerous, which was why I think I was never bullied, because they weren't quite sure.
It's a bit unhinged, this one.
What might happen, you know?
Which way this is going to go. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Wonderful.
But interestingly, after, you know, as I listened to people like Frank Trumbauer, and then I moved on to the 30s, and I was very interested in Lester, obviously. Benny Carter was another hero of mine. And I can still hear all those players in my own playing. There's still little elements of that music. And I'm pleased about that, you know.
I think that what I hear in that when I hear you is that sense of a song, of a playing a song.
Yes, like very much.
Yeah. So, you know, that kind of melodic thing of making a song really sing, like a great singer. And I think that's like, that was quite an aesthetic in those that, like Lester Young, who was trying to sound like a singer almost when they play a melody, you know, the strength of the melody. I think later it was much more about the solo, wasn't it? But the early jazz has that reverence for the melody and how you can make an individual statement with a melody. As well.
Yeah, and of course, a lot of the improvising was based on the melody rather than based on a detailed sequence. Knowledge of a harmonic sequence.
Sure. Very interesting that. So, at what age? Because was the transition, and was that? So it sounds like that was a fairly natural transition to the saxophone. Was it alto straight away? Was it always?
It was. I played a little bit of clarinet alto. Yeah. My older brother Peter, for some obscure reason, had bought a second-hand alto. I don't know why, because he was a piano player. But and the little band I was playing with, the clarinet player left, and you know, his family moved away. And I said, "Oh, I'll have a go at that. My brother's got an alto," and so I started playing. And immediately, it really felt that's what I should be doing. It was that's where I could hear music. Was the alto saxophone?
That's very interesting.
Quite extraordinary, yeah.
Yeah. I actually played the alto for a few years when I was really young. Yeah. Yeah, you didn't know that, did you? Yeah.
No, I didn't know that.
No, I spent quite a few years. I worked pretty hard on it, but I think I'd already done a lot of drumming. That was where I could hear that sort of the register or something about the sound of the alto drew me to that. Maybe,
yeah, I don't know.
Maybe it's a drummer thing. I don't know. But interesting. Yeah. Okay, cool. So what we're going to play now is we've got an audio track and you've kindly supplied some fantastic pictures as well. So we've got some pictures of the trio, which we'll see on the slideshow. But this is another live album, a fairly recent one again, from March 2018. This is live at the Oval Tavern in Croydon. And this is with the great tenor player, Chris Cheek, who you work very well with. I think you both play, you know, very nicely together. You sort of felt kind of like in tune, like stylistically.
I mean, we met for the first time 15 minutes before we started playing.
Amazing. I didn't know that. Yeah.
Yeah. Simon Wolford suggested that I did this lunchtime gig with Chris Cheek, and it's a quartet with just bass and drums and two horns, and we all arrived and at 12:15, and the gig started at 12:30, and I'd scribbled down a few tunes, and Chris, who's an absolutely delightful guy, Those are fine. Yeah, I know that. Yeah, or oh, don't know that. Or oh, what about this? Yeah, okay, we've got two sets, and we just launched into it. And I think, and there was an immediate sort of empathy between all of us, which I think comes across in the recording. But I loved his playing. I thought he had all the qualities of a respect for the tradition of the music, but a real personal voice. You know, that's, a real personal and quite idiosyncratic way of improvising, which I thought was delightful. Yeah.
So we've got this, and this is so this is interesting again. So there's no. This is two horns, bass and drums. It's Simon Wolf and Sebastian de Crom on the drums. Yeah. Great drummer.
That's right.
And great bass player. Was that a decision, or was it like the classic Coltrane thing where they? Well, they said, well, you know, were you thinking of this and that? And he goes, oh, no, he just didn't turn up. You know?
No, it was, I mean, it was Simon Wolf who thought he was booking all the gigs for Chris. And he said he thought it would be great to do a quartet with bass drums and two horns. And he asked, he thought I'd work well with Chris. And so that was a deliberate decision.
A good play there by Simon putting you guys together. And again, just that thing of, do you find there's more freedom in that without having that?
Very much so. I mean, in the case where there's just bass and drums, of course, there's much more harmonic freedom because the harmonic information is just the bass line.
So you can play almost anything on that without...
So there's much more freedom for the two horns to interact. Sure.
Wonderful. So we've got this track now, and this is Hot House, which is by Tad Dameron. Which is a contrafact, right? And that's on What Is This Thing Called Love by Cole Porter. So if you hum What Is This Thing Called Love over the top, you should be able to stay with it, folks. So here we go. This is Hot House live from the Oval Tavern in Croydon.
Thank you.
Enjoying the show. I just want to take a moment to tell you about a new way that you can help support me do this, and that is through patreon.com. That's right, I've got an account now, so the link's below here, patreon.com/BusterBirch, and if you go along to there, you can now make donations by Visa credit card, so you don't have to use PayPal if you don't want to do that. And the advantage of Patreon is that once you do it once, it will automatically deduct on a per show basis. So instead of having to fill in the forms every week, if you want to make a regular donation, then that will just automatically deduct straight to your credit card each per show. And that is hugely helpful to me because it means I know that I've got a certain amount coming in every time I do a show, and that really helps me plan ahead and keeps the viable sustainability of the show going. There's two levels of sponsorship. There's my silver and gold membership. All of my Patreon supporters will get a big thank you personally from me live on the show, and the gold member sponsors will get an additional Spotify playlist, which will be sent to you each week. It's something that I'm putting together. It's personally curated by me and will feature lots more albums by the guest artists each week. So it's a great opportunity to get to know this music much better. If you're really enjoying the show and you like the little tasters that you're hearing, that's a great way to get to know this music even more and enjoy in full comfort the full sound of the full albums. Thanks very much. Back to the show. That's right, I'm here with Geoff Simkins, and that we've just heard Hot House there. It's a live gig, but it was recorded, and there's an album, and you can get that, folks, on Bandcamp, which is on Simon Wolf's page. And again, there's a link below. If you look down, and if you open the description in the bottom of the YouTube thing where it says "See More," click on that, and you'll see there's some links down there. You can get that. Geoff's, with regard to Spotify, Geoff's not on Spotify, but what I've done is I've made some playlists of some Lenny Tristano, some Lee Konitz, and some Warren Marsh, who I thought we could talk about now, who I know of the great influences on Geoff. And so I thought that would be really nice bit of interesting background listening. If you want to check out some of that music, that would help you to sort of get a feel for where Geoff's coming from on some of these things. So Geoff, yeah, so wonderful, great. Great, you know, it's great, isn't it? Sometimes with jazz, somebody put a poem on Facebook, Pete Churchill put a poem up on Facebook today, and it's a really good poem, and I can't remember it, I'm not going to mess it up, but it was to do with about how jazz is, how many great jazz gigs there's been, live gigs, that we'll never hear, that are lost, that are gone. You know, so for all the albums in the world, there's a thousand gigs that happened. You know, that unless you were there, you missed it. But there's but it's nice when you get these live recordings, isn't it? And what's really nice is when it all comes together like that, because sometimes you set these things up and it doesn't quite work. And for you to just, was that planned, that recording, or they just happened to run the tapes?
No, somebody was there who recorded some of those Sunday gigs, and he turned up with his equipment and recorded it, and then amazing. I think sent it to Simon and said, you know, I've got this recording of the gig, and
brilliant.
Simon played it to a couple of people, and Chris was very keen to. He said that great, let's put it out. And so
fantastic. So there we go, folks. We've got a nice little. We've captured a Sunday lunchtime in Croydon there, and what a great result of as well.
I mean, leading on from that, and talking, we're talking about Warren Marsh. In I think on one of the few visits that Warren Marsh made to London, he did some duos with the pianist Lou Levy at the Pizza on the Park, and I went one night to see Warren Marsh and Lou Levy. It was absolutely breathtaking music. But somebody had said at the beginning of the gig, this is in the days of cassette recorders, and somebody had gone up to Warren Marsh and said, can I record the gig? And this is before phones. This is when he took a cassette recorder. And Warren Marsh was very insistent and said, no, you can't record it. I get one chance to play this music. You get one chance to hear it. Yeah. And that's sort of, you know, if you said that to somebody now within the era of phones and iPads and
moaning
whatever.
All the time, aren't they? But yes, there is something about, because Simon, I know Simon Spillett, you won't mind me saying, we talked about it, you know, he has a bit of a thing about this as well. I think there's something about asking permission, obviously. I mean, people do it without even asking, which is just rude, isn't it? But I know myself, when we've done some gigs with Alison's band, and when you know that the album's been, when it's being recorded, there's something about the pressure that puts on you subconsciously. And I do think it makes you play differently. And I don't think the people in the audience realize that. I don't think they quite appreciate what it is they're asking when they say to you, oh, can I just film this or put it, or, you know, for YouTube, where, and suddenly, cause I, you know, you sort of go, oh God, here we go. You know, so, and it really changes the dynamic, cause you've come out. And especially, and what they don't realise is, you may not have met any of these people before on some of these jazz gigs. Sure. So you're sort of thinking, oh, you're going out, having a nice time, thinking, all right, and there's a freedom there that you can just play and enjoy the gig. And the moment someone's, it does, I mean, like, there's a point where you've done enough of it, you go, oh, okay, fine, you know. Mm. But I think, but it does change something, doesn't it? In the way you play, do you think? I don't know.
And sometimes, why shouldn't it be the case that you're in a room with the other musicians and the audience, people you've never met who are sitting listening. There's an atmosphere in the room. The musicians play. Yeah. The music's wonderful, and then it's gone, and it can't be captured except in the memory. Yeah. Why not? You
know. And there's a magic of, like,
yes,
it
right.
makes it a special thing. Then doesn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, it does affect the player, I think. Certainly, well, it does for me anyway. I find I play safe, you know, much more.
Yeah, sure.
Even though I keep telling myself, don't play safe. Play more. So then you get this little voice, you know, and then you're in a right state. The only way to do it is to go, oh, to hell with it, isn't it? Yeah. So let's, I mean, if you don't mind, we can talk a little bit about something. I know you're, you know, very, it's, you know, you're known for being this champion of the Lenny Tristano school of approach to play. I know that you're not, this is the trouble, is when people label people, that's not all you're about. I mean, I'm very aware of that. You have a much broader approach and holistic approach to improvising than that. But that is a particular thing. So, and you talked about then Lester Young and this kind of evolution. So at what point did you kind of discover this thing, this Lenny Tristano thing with the...
I was working at a hotel in the Channel Islands with a band, and I was sharing a room with a great bass player called Lindsay Cooper, who sadly has died, but he was a lovely guy, Lynn. And he, one night we were just having a drink after the gig in the room, and he said, "Here, Geoff, have you heard Lee Konitz?" And I sort of said, well, I know the name. And he just put this recording on, and it was a sort of light bulb moment. It was it was as if somebody had explained what could be done, sort of cleared up so much stuff that was going on in my head.
Wow.
And it wasn't that I wanted to copy that, but it was an approach to playing, an approach to improvising using melody and sound and time that I thought that's what I have to do. Yeah, it was an extraordinary moment.
And
it cleared up so much. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so then when I looked to see where Konitz had come from musically, it of course led me to Lenny Tristano and his approach to teaching. And Tristano was one of the very first jazz musicians who thought about teaching in a structured way, as if that was an important part of carrying on the tradition of the music. And his philosophy of teaching was you know, everything that I'd sort of aspired to. I thought, this is fantastic. It involves singing, it involves singing solos, it involves assimilating and sort of deeply internalizing the music by singing and then playing, not by copying what's written down, but in a sort of organic way, so that you not only learn and assimilate and internalize the notes, but it's the articulation, it's the dynamics, right, it's the tempo, it's the song, it's all the detail.
There's so much missing, isn't there? I mean, I have a beef about this with the real books a lot when I'm teaching, you know, and I'm often saying, you've got to go to the record. You can't learn from a lead sheet. There's so little information. There's so much you're missing. But I mean, Giustano famously was very a great taskmaster.
He demanded
a lot from his students.
The student had to learn to sing the solo before they ever tried to play it. Mm. So you had to sing the solo and then sing the solo with the recording, and then sing the solo without the recording, and then play it. And that really, I mean, that's the sort of thing I'd done when I learned to play, because I learned to play by doing that, you know. So I learned by ear, and so that was quite a logical way of doing it. But he'd taken it to steps and steps further than I'd ever dreamed of. But it was an approach which I understood, therefore I found it quite easy to get into that way of learning, but also teaching when I started to teach, you know.
Yeah, and it does require a lot of dedication, because it's true.
Huge amount, yes. Yeah. I mean, he demanded that students signed up for a year at a time, and you had to turn down gigs if it meant missing a lesson. So he was incredibly strict about that.
I can't see that catching on now, can you?
Well, no, it's okay for me because I don't get any gigs, so I wouldn't be missing anything. But no, I thought that was. That was great. And the other thing that was, I think, often misunderstood about Tristano is that what he wanted was for all his students to find a way of playing that was authentic for them. He didn't try and impose a way of playing.
Right.
One of his contemporaries said, very interestingly, because Parker and Tristano had a great mutual admiration for each other, although they were very different players. But somebody said that Parker didn't teach anybody directly and yet had thousands and thousands of people trying to copy him, whereas Tristano probably had thousands of students over the years and insisted that they all try and play like themselves. That's something I think is often misunderstood. You had to find your own voice, and I think that's something I've tried to do as a teacher, you know.
And it's about developing skills, isn't it? Essentially a skill set that enables you to express,
to have
whatever
the confidence to express yourself.
That you want to express, And and as you say, it takes a lot of work, a lot of work. Mm. It's no sort of easy undertaking. Well, we've got this recording now I'd like to look at, and we can talk about, we can mention at this point, I think, Dave Cliff, who's a wonderful guitarist, incredible musician, great player. Lovely chap, a very good dear friend of ours, and Dave's going to be on the show. Dave's going to be one of my guests in 2 or 3 weeks' time, so we'll look forward to that. But Dave's someone that you've had a great musical partnership with for a long time, and we talked about this before with other people, and it's very interesting, this thing with jazz about finding your voice, like you say as well. But I think there's something in the relationships you have with people personally that enable you to play this music, unlike other music, where you're playing a written part, a fixed part. I mean, you still got to play the thing. But when you're playing jazz, particularly when it's a lot of, you know, improvised, heavily improvised music, you're creating the music in the moment. So the result of that kind of relies on the connection that you make with each other, isn't it? And how you
very much
and
so, so
when
yeah.
you do get these connections, there's something magic, isn't there, about
yes.
that? And it can be really the thing that creates that is responsible for this music. And when you find that person, it can be straight away, can't it? It's very strange.
Yeah, and I mean, I've done a lot of duo playing with Dave over the years, and saxophone and guitar duo is a very hard one, particularly for the guitar player, of course. But he plays a
solid body, doesn't he?
He doesn't
play a normal jazz guitar. No. He plays like, is it a Strat or something, a Telecaster? One of these, like an electric, like when I first saw it, I was like, what's that? Because he doesn't... And then he played, and it sounds beautiful. He's got this very unique, again, individual sound on there. But it's... So again, like, that's not necessarily a... But there's something about the musical kinship that you have that makes it work, and that's about listening to each other.
It's a trust, actually, Buster. It's a sort of trust... That you know that you can do anything you want, and the other person or the other musicians are going to respond in an appropriate and generous way, and it just makes everything much more exciting, I think.
Brilliant. So we've got there's a great album you made together, and this is going back a little bit. It's probably sort of mid to late 90s, is it? The Sipping at Bells, and again, a fantastic rhythm section here. We've got Simon Wolfe on the bass again. And Mark Taylor on the drums, who you know, is an incredible player, and yourself and Dave. And so we've got this track we're going to play from. It's called That Old Feeling / Ronnie's Line. So there's a connection there as well with what we were just talking about, isn't there?
The theme at the beginning is That Old Feeling, which is a standard by Sammy Fain, I think, and then the solos and various interplay. But the theme at the end is another contrafact, and it was a line written by a British piano player called Ronnie Ball, who went to New York to study with Tristano in the early 50s. He was a good piano player from Birmingham, and he followed Peter in to New York and studied with Tristano and made some recordings with Konitz and Marsh and Ted Brown and people. And he wrote a line over That Old Feeling called Ronnie's Line, which is a fiendishly difficult thing. And I remember saying to Dave on the recording, look, you know, if we get that far, I'll have a go at Ronnie's Line on the out chorus. Brilliant. And I remember starting to play it, and I think if this goes wrong, the whole take is
Should have done that at the front, and then that would have been made life a bit easier. Yeah,
that's right. But, you know.
No, wonderful, wonderful. So here we go. This is The Old Feeling with Ronnie's Line at the end. And this is from the album Sipping at Bells.
Thank you.
Wonderful. And that was my guest, Geoff Simkins, with the great Dave Cliff on guitar, Simon Wolf on bass, and Mark Taylor on the drums. And actually, if you, we mentioned earlier about Dave Cliff's very distinctive guitar sound. And for those regular listeners to my show or watchers of my show, you will know that guitar sound, because that is the guitar sound for my theme tune. I say my theme tune, it's actually I should qualify that. That's it's a track taken from an album by my wife, Joe Fuchs, and Dave Cliff played in the quintet with us, and we recorded a couple of albums with Dave. So I'm looking forward to Dave coming on and we can talk to him about that. So wonderful, wonderful swinging, great swinging group that, really. And we're just talking about, again, that feel, you know, that time feel, and those lines, interweaving lines that you all kind of play off each other. It's just wonderful, brilliant. I guess we should mention a little bit about your teaching as well, because you've been you're a highly respected teacher. You've had a lot of students pass through. And later on, at the end of the show, we're gonna play a clip of a video of a quintet with you led by all students that you've taught, who now are, you know, great musicians doing great things, professional jazz musicians doing very well. And that must be a nice thing, seeing that coming through, and, you know, this whole process of I don't know, passing down the history of the music. It's all part of what we do, isn't it? I think that's a big part of it.
Yeah, very much so. And I'm fortunate in the sense that I found, when I started teaching, I first taught at the Glamorgan Summer School, I think 1987 or something, and it was actually Gordon Beck and Brian Waite who first said, would I be interested in doing it? And you know, that was a fantastic gesture from them to say they thought I could do that. And it really started me thinking about teaching as part of my income, but part of being a jazz musician, as part of being an improviser, was being a teacher. And so certainly going back to Tristano, it's something he felt was very important. And I came across a quote that Tristano's made, and Tristano said, it's beautiful to assist people in developing the ability to create. And I thought that was a wonderful thing to say. And he felt that it was just as important to do that as it was to make recordings and play.
I
found that over the years, teaching at conservatoires, but also doing my Saturday morning workshops in Brighton, which I've done for many years, and one-to-one lessons, that it's great to be able to guide people, perhaps mentor people, so that they can find their own way of expressing themselves. I think it's a wonderful thing to do. Yeah,
it's a gift, isn't it? It's a lot of work, but it's that. I think that's a beautiful way of putting it. I've not heard that before, and I think that chimes and resonates very strongly with me. Mm. Yeah, just to you're passing on this thing to enable people to express themselves and do something to create stuff, something that's meaningful and valuable, isn't it? And that's important, isn't it? I think
it's drawing on the great tradition of the music, but then using all that knowledge, but then finding a way of using it to express what you're feeling about yourself, about life, about the music. And I think it's exactly what Tristano was trying to do all those years ago.
Brilliant.
Yeah. And it's what I found Chris Cheek was doing in on that recording there, who has that, obviously, that respect and knowledge of the history of the tenor saxophone, and yet was able to make a really personal and quite quirky way of improvising, which I thought was delightful.
We've got this track now, which is a ballad, and it's from the same album, The Sipping at Bells. And I have to say, Geoff, I think hearing you on a ballad is just about as good as it gets. And I know, you know, we've been chums for a long time through summer school, and we've been, I've had the pleasure of hearing you. Hey, you, that might be a gig.
Might be a gig. Yeah. but on the other hand, Buster, experience tells me.
It could be your Ricardo deliveries are running early.
I think it's probably a final demand, actually.
There's that great interview with Jackie Byard where that happens, and he's getting into it, and he's talking, and it keeps ringing. He goes, "I've got to get that. That might be a good." Anyway, so hearing you every year, as I do, get to hear you, have the pleasure of seeing you at our summer school, and hanging out and hearing you play in the club most nights of the week. And there's something about, and I don't know, maybe, you know, I'd be interested to see what you think about this, but you've always, I mean, it was like, it hit me between the eyes when I first heard you, and you always do this, and there's just something about the way you play and that we hear, particularly on a ballad, the soulfulness of, when I hear you play and improvise, I hear the whole history of the music, the whole history of jazz in there. I hear the incredible brilliance of what it is that you're doing. I hear your individualness as an artist, but I also hear this incredible soulfulness where I hear like, and it's like you have, it sounds like somebody sort of summing it all up when you play, and you do that every single time I hear you play. And I don't know how you quite manage that. It's just always just incredible, and knocks my socks off. And I've often wondered, like, do you think you can teach that, or is there just something, there's that X factor thing, or is it just like the years of evolution of dedication to the art? I mean, I guess there is no shortcuts, obviously, but is there a point at which I'm wondering that you've reached that just we can't all reach, you know,
I think in the end it's to do with being authentic, it's to do with being honest, and I think you have to find a way of playing which is authentic to you. I'm not trying to please an audience or please a section of an audience or even please the other musicians. I'm trying to play because it's what I want to do, which is quite selfish in a way. And I think once you find a way of playing which is authentic, then the people that are drawn to that will, it's like a radio station, they'll tune in and they'll stay with it. The people that don't like it, that's fine. They can go and listen to something else. But I'm not trying to please anybody. I'm trying to say, this is how I feel about this song at this particular minute. And a student once said to me, but who knows that you're being authentic? And I said, well, I do. I know, for crying out loud. That's the important thing, you know. And you know, if you're playing and you're not being authentic, you know.
And that's all that matters.
Yeah. So, brilliant. You know, don't try and fool me. You know whether you're being authentic or not.
Right. Okay. That's wonderful. Yeah. Well, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah. It's just every solo, I always think, well, you could sort of almost clock out on that one, you know, but you do it every single time, you know. It's like that. I'd be happy with that, like, if I ever did that, you know. But it's that, I think it's that consistency which always knocks me out as well. But that's just the dedication, isn't it, to the art and to the years of work.
Yeah, it's just years of tiresome practice.
Fantastic. Well, having said all that, I think what we're going to do now, we're going to play this track, because I just think this is absolutely sublime. This is a ballad, and it's I Guess I'll Hang My Tears Out to Dry, and it's from the album Sipping at Bell. Absolutely sublime, and that is just wonderful. And I think that sums up what I was trying to clumsily say earlier, Geoff, about, you know, this great summing up and hearing you on a ballad. And I think that is the height of artistry, and hearing a jazz musician play a ballad like that, because, and it's, you know, it's an old thing everybody says, and but it really does just show a lot, doesn't it?
I mean, yeah, and also, of course, you know, Dave's playing and Simon's absolutely beautiful. You know, great choice of line, of bass line, of beautiful sound and delicate interjections. Fantastic, you know.
Yeah. Wonderful. And so that's our album is Sipping at Bells. And I think we'll probably hear a bit more from that album when Dave comes on. But do check it out, folks. It's a great album. So well, the time's marching on again. Unfortunately, it does go very quickly. And but it's been great. I think what we've just got time to, we'll wrap it up with this video. We've got, we were talking earlier about some of your teaching, your students, and how, you know, there's this great crop of young players coming through now, and they really are, I mean, they get better and better and younger, and it's just great to hear them. And this group is entirely... I guess some of them are ex-students now. I know Corey Dick's doing very well. He's an ex-Trinity
Corrie, I taught her first year at Trinity, and Tom Ollendorf on guitar and Joe Webb on piano. I taught for virtually the whole 4 years at the Welsh College at Cardiff. And Will Satch on bass I met at the Academy. So I've had a hand in all their sort of studies. And I've kept in touch with them all since they left college and done gigs with them. And we decided to do some gigs as a quintet, which for me is quite a big band. To have to organize five musicians is quite a lot for me. But in the same way, you know, with Nicky or Dave and Dave Green and such, Chris Cheek, they're all such generous musicians and guys in their 20s, but again, with that love of the tradition of the music and yet the desire to take that information and that knowledge and then make something new out of it. And they're all involved in lots of contemporary projects, but still can play in the tradition. And I think that's what's beautiful and still make something new out of the music. Yeah, fantastic. I love playing with them. And again, they're all able to respond and to change direction at a moment's notice and be willing and generous enough to want to do that. Yeah.
Well, I think it's testimony to the great teaching as well that they get. So that's fair. I think for me, Tom really, young Tom there stands at he's matching you on those lines with those fantastic unison lines, and they're not easy lines, are they?
No,
and he's
just
got that nice, relaxed feel, and he's right with you. I think that really comes across. Well, what we'll do is we'll say a few thank yous and goodbyes, and then we'll end on this video. I'll play out with this video, folks. So, but before we say goodbye, I just wanted to say once again thanks to everybody for tuning in. It's great. It's nice to see the comments on the chat box, and I really appreciate your support. If you have enjoyed the show, you wouldn't mind making a little contribution. We've got PayPal there, or if you want to make a regular donation on the Patreon link, that's below as well. And it's been great. I'm really enjoying doing these. So we're booked up now through to the end of next month. I've got some great guest artists coming on. Do check my website. It's just busterbirch.co.uk/virtualjazzclub. You'll see the schedule for the next few weeks. So, well, Geoff, it's flown past.
It has.
It's been great. I mean, I knew it would be. I knew you'd be a great guest. You're always very articulate and very interesting. And you know, it's great to have a bit of time to sit down and talk to you about this stuff, because as we say every year summer school, it's always a bit frantic, isn't it? So we don't as much as you think I've got a whole week, it doesn't have to go in a blink, doesn't it? I'm usually running around sorting things out, so it's been a real pleasure to sit and spend this time and chat with you about music and get some of your great insights as well. I do appreciate that. So
it's been wonderful. Thank you, Buster. Great.
Thanks Geoff. Well, thanks everyone, do tune in and tell your friends, and they can sign up on the mailing list. You get an email once a week, 1 hour before the show, and that will give you the link to watch us live. Other than that, you can watch us the replay on YouTube. We'll be back next week, and I've got the great Dave O'Higgins next week, a very fine saxophone player, and different sort of style. I'm sure that'll be really interesting. He's got a lot of albums and a lot of projects on the go. So, and again, very articulate, intelligent chat, very much like my guest this evening. And so I'll look forward to that. So take care of yourselves, everybody. Thanks for tuning in. And we'll leave you with this video now, which is a live recording from a gig. This is at the Verdict again, is it right?
It is, yeah.
When was it? This one was fairly
recent. 2019, so it's just last about 18 months ago. And it's another Lenny Tristano June. It's 317 East 32nd Street. Which
do we know what was at 317?
It was Tristano's studio,
his school, his house where he lived and taught. Right, brilliant. Thanks, Geoff. Thanks, everyone. I'll leave you with this. Good night.